Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower, and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
On today's program, you will hear stories from Brian Lynn and Dan Friedell. Later, Gregory Stachel presents this week's Health and Lifestyle Report. Finally, we visit Crater Lake National Park in Oregon as we continue our U.S. parks journey. But first,
Twitter owner Elon Musk has launched a new logo, the single letter X, to replace the social media service's famous blue bird. The X design started appearing at the top of Twitter's computer version on Monday, but the old bird logo could still be seen across areas of the service. Musk announced in a Twitter message Sunday that he had decided to change the company's logo. He said he had asked his millions of followers to provide logo ideas and if they would favor a change in the service's colors from blue to black. When asked what tweets would be called without the bluebird logo, Musk said they would now be known as X's. The latest change is one in a series Musk has carried out since buying Twitter for $44 billion last year. The billionaire businessman dismissed about 75% of the company's workforce soon after the deal closed. Musk said the move was necessary to make Twitter more effective and increase profits. He also announced plans to start charging Twitter users $8 a month to keep a verified account. As Twitter chief, Musk also lifted some existing restrictions on user content. He said those changes were part of a larger effort to protect the free speech of Twitter users. Critics said his plans were likely to increase the amount of harmful content and hate speech appearing on the service. Musk's changes led to drops in the number of Twitter users. Some advertisers stopped doing business with the company as well. In a message on Twitter Monday, Chief Executive Linda Yaccarino wrote, "X is here, let's do this." Along with her message, she published a picture of the logo projected onto the building's headquarters in San Francisco. Musk also commented on the logo change, writing, "And soon we shall bid adieu to the Twitter brand and gradually all the birds." Musk said the X.com web domain was already redirecting users to Twitter.com. A three-member team designed the first Twitter logo in 2012. One of those designers, Martin Grasser, described the Bluebird logo as simple, balanced, and easy to read at very small sizes. Matt Rhodes is with the British creative agency House 337. He told news agency Reuters that making changes to such an established brand presents big business risks. Anything that makes it harder for people to find or want to open the app on their cluttered phone screens risks harming usage, Rhodes said. However, Paolo Pescatore, a technology and media specialist who founded advisory company PP Foresight, said the change could be good. He spoke to the Associated Press. Pescatore said social media users currently can get confused by too many apps and messaging services to choose from. Driving users to one central place will engage more users and could make Twitter easier to use, he said. Musk has long been interested in the letter X. He had already changed Twitter's official name to X Corp after buying the company. The billionaire is also CEO of rocket company Space Exploration Technologies Corporation, commonly known as SpaceX. He started an artificial intelligence company this month called XAI to compete with OpenAI. And in 1999, he founded a startup called X.com, an online financial services company now known as PayPal. Musk's Twitter purchase and rebranding effort are seen as steps toward his stated plans to create what he has called an everything app. Such an app would be similar to China's WeChat, which combines video, messaging, streaming, and payments. Yasserino wrote on Twitter that she sees X becoming the future state of unlimited interactivity, centered in audio, video, messaging, payments, and banking, creating a global marketplace for ideas, goods, services, and opportunities. I'm Brian Lynn.
Jill Biden, the First Lady of the United States, is in Paris this week to announce her country's return to UNESCO. UNESCO is the educational, cultural, and scientific organization of the United Nations. Biden flew overnight and arrived with her daughter Ashley early on Monday to be there for Tuesday's ceremony. They will see the American flag raised to mark the U.S. return to UNESCO after 5 years. UNESCO is the organization that designates World Heritage Sites, noting they should be marked for eternal preservation. Eternal means something that lasts forever. The organization also works to create collaboration among nations in education, science, and culture. UNESCO recently denounced attacks by Russia on Ukraine that have damaged historical places, such as a church in Odessa. The organization noted Russia had earlier agreed to limit attacks to prevent damage on such places. The Bidens will return to the U.S. on Wednesday, but they plan to visit the famous Mont Saint-Michel before they leave. The place is a World Heritage Site in Normandy, in northern France. Jill Biden will also meet with Brigitte Macron, the wife of French President Emmanuel Macron. Spokespeople from the administration of President Joe Biden said rejoining UNESCO was part of the president's goal to strengthen partnerships around the world. The administration also said it shows America's interest in being a UN leader. Others said Jill Biden was the right person to take part in Tuesday's event because of her experience as a teacher and college professor. Elizabeth Alexander is a spokesperson for Biden. She said, "The First Lady is honored to help celebrate this important milestone."
The U.S. left UNESCO in 2018 during President Donald Trump's time in office. Trump's administration was protesting what it called unfair treatment of Israel by UNESCO. UNESCO voted earlier in July to approve the United States' readmission to the group. As part of rejoining UNESCO, the U.S. will pay more than $600 million over a number of coming years. That amount includes what the U.S. would have paid had it been a member since 2018. Clubs, labor groups, and other organizations call these amounts dues. The U.S. also withdrew from UNESCO in the 1980s during Ronald Reagan's presidency. It rejoined the group in 2003 under President George W. Bush. Bush's wife, Laura, announced the move at a UNESCO meeting that year. I'm Dan Friedell.
Almost every flower can be cut and enjoyed indoors. But growing a cutting garden of flowers takes some planning. Jessica Damiano writes about gardening for the Associated Press. Damiano says that she cuts lilacs to bring indoors for their scent in the spring. And hydrangeas and roses make it indoors on her dining room table for the summer. The first step, Damiano says, is to think about flowers as a crop to be harvested. Just as some tomatoes are better for use in sauces, some flowers are better for cutting and showing than others. Flowers that do not grow tall nor bloom are not the best to show indoors. Damiano says to look for this information in seed catalogs. The descriptions often include whether specific kinds of flowers, from perennials, annuals, or tender perennials, work well for cutting and showing. Perennials are plants that flower for more than 1 year. Some flower for just 2 or 3 weeks, while others flower repeatedly. And they usually flower in their second year, but sometimes third. Annuals are plants that live for just 1 year, but they usually produce more flowers during the growing season. Tender perennials are perennials in the sense that they live for more than 1 year. But they are usually grown as annuals because some do not dependably return and some cannot survive winters. To ensure a continual supply of flowers for cutting, Damiano says to plant seeds or young plants every 2 weeks. Annuals that are good for cutting include cosmos, globe amaranth, larkspur, and Queen Anne's lace. Perennials to grow and cut include bee balm, coneflower, foxglove, lily, and rose. Tender perennials that work well for cutting include California poppy, snapdragon, and strawflower. Both annuals and perennials can be grown in the ground, in raised beds, or even in containers. If you have enough room, growing them in separate beds will simplify yearly planting, but it is not necessary. If you are short on space, plant where you can. Most flowers need fertile, well-draining soil, repeated watering, and at least 6 to 8 hours of direct sunlight each day. You can use plants bought from a garden center, start your own from seed indoors, or plant seeds directly into the garden. Add a large amount of compost into planting holes to provide nutrients to the plants. If you're planning ahead, top the soil with 5 to 8 centimeters of compost in the fall, and the bed will be highly fertile by spring. Beds should not be much wider than a meter. This will help to keep your harvests within easy reach from all sides. When planting, place the tallest flowers at the backside of the bed, middle-sized plants in the center, and smaller plants in the front so that all are easy to get to. Be sure to follow directions for plants on how much space they need to understand their full-grown size. Plants that do not have enough space often become diseased plants. After planting, add a balanced, slow-release fertilizer and 5 to 8 centimeters of mulch, then water well. If you are planting seeds directly into the garden, fertilize and mulch when the growing plants are 10 centimeters tall. Beginning 3 weeks after planting, add a liquid flower fertilizer that is low in nitrogen and high in phosphorus, and repeat every 2 weeks. I'm Gregory Stachel.
You just heard this week's Health and Lifestyle Report, presented by Gregory Stachel. Gregory joins me now to talk more about the story. Hi, Greg. Good to have you on the show.
Hi, Ashley. Thanks for having me.
In the story, you explain the difference between annual and perennial flowers. Annuals usually only live for one growing season, while perennials can return year after year. I was wondering if you could talk with us about how we use annual and perennial in situations outside of gardening and plants.
Well, Ashley, we can use the word annual when we want to talk about something that happens over a year or yearly. For example, we might say annual rainfall to talk about the rainfall in a place over a year, or an annual publication for a book or magazine that comes out once a year. Perennial, on the other hand, can be used when we want to describe something as being never-ending. So you might say that someone has perennial beauty when their looks have not changed over a long period of time.
Great. Thanks so much for those explanations, Gregory. And thank you again for your report today.
You're welcome.
On our national parks journey, we travel to the northwestern state of Oregon. Here, you will find a huge, deep lake. Its waters seem impossibly blue. It is the deepest lake in America and one of the deepest lakes in the world. Its water is among the clearest and purest found on Earth. Around the lake runs the wall of an extinct volcano. In the middle of the lake a small island rises over 230 meters above the surface. Welcome to Crater Lake National Park.
The lake's beauty inspires artists, photographers, and nature lovers. That beauty was born from the violent burst of Mount Mazama about 7,700 years ago. Hot liquid called magma rose from deep under the mountain, causing it to collapse. The powerful burst destroyed the surrounding area. Huge amounts of ash fell on the land. The burst also left an enormous circular hole in the mountain's center. Scientists call this a caldera. Over the next hundreds of years, rain and snow filled the hole with water. Rainfall and snowfall are the lake's only source of water. It has no connections to the rivers and streams around it. That is what keeps its waters so pure. As water collected, plants began to grow in the area again, and animals returned. Scientists say it took about 250 years for the lake to rise to its current water level. Crater Lake is 592 meters deep. It is one of the 10 deepest on Earth. But its depth is not the only remarkable quality. People are awed by its water color and clarity. Crater Lake is so clear that on most days you can see nearly 30 meters below the surface. The lake takes on its intense blue color because of the water's clarity. Sunlight reaches deep into the water. Crater Lake gets its name from geology. A crater is a large, bowl-shaped area on top of a volcano. The crater that formed the lake sits within the larger caldera.
Native Americans were in the area even before the lake's formation. Researchers have found artifacts buried under layers of ash and dust from Mount Mazama's huge eruption. Following the burst, Native Americans considered Crater Lake to be a holy place. Ancient Native American stories describe the eruption of Mount Mazama. European explorers and settlers did not arrive in the area until the middle 1800s. In 1865, a hunter became one of the first non-Native Americans to reach the shores of Crater Lake. In 1870, a boy in Kansas read a newspaper article about the strange lake in Oregon. The story about Crater Lake fascinated the young William Gladstone Steele. He promised himself he would one day see this lake. In 1872, Steele's family moved to Portland, Oregon, about 375 kilometers north of the lake. 13 years later, Steele honored his promise and visited Crater Lake. Its beauty moved him greatly. He began a 17-year fight to preserve the area as a public park. Steele was a writer. He described one of his first visits to Crater Lake In 1886, in the West Shore magazine.
Not a foot of the land about the lake has been touched or claimed. An overmastering conviction came to me that this wonderful spot must be saved, wild and beautiful, just as it was, for all future generations.
His proposal of creating a national park did not please nearby sheep herders and miners. But his efforts succeeded anyway. On May 22, 1902, Crater Lake became the country's fifth national park. It remains the only national park in Oregon. And William Gladstone Steele is called the father of Crater Lake.
Crater Lake National Park covers 740 square kilometers. The lake itself makes up less than 10% of the park. It also includes surrounding mountains and thick forests. The trees shelter many kinds of animals, from black bears to elk to spotted owls. About 480,000 people visit Crater Lake National Park each year. They explore by car, bicycle, or on foot. Roads that encircle Crater Lake usually are open from July through October, depending on weather. They provide breathtaking displays of the lake's unusual blue color, as well as the forests around it. Crater Lake National Park also has more than 140 kilometers of hiking trails. The Cleetwood Cove Trail drops more than 200 meters down to the edge of Crater Lake. It leads to a spot where swimming is permitted. The water is extremely cold. Most swimmers cannot stay in for more than a few minutes. Crater Lake's average water temperature is just 3 degrees Celsius. In summer, the lake's surface warms to about 10 degrees Celsius.
Visitors can also catch a boat from the end of Cleetwood Cove Trail. Park rangers lead visitors on boat rides around the lake. Visitors can also take boats to Wizard Island. The piece of land sits in the western part of the lake. Volcanic eruptions formed Wizard Island. It rises over 760 meters above the lake floor. However, most of the island, about 500 meters, is underwater. At Wizard Island, visitors can hike, swim, and fish. It is also a wonderful place to relax and enjoy nature. But such extraordinary places can be found all over the park. Discovering one's own is part of the magic to experience at Crater Lake National Park. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Caty Weaver.
That's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak.